I'm pleased to introduce our keynote speaker, Professor Kathleen Komar. She earned her doctorate in comparative literature from Princeton University and is currently a distinguished professor of comparative literature and German at UCLA. She's been awarded UCLA's Distinguished Teaching Award. This, by the way, is the award that I regard as the most difficult and the most prestigious award to get at UCLA. If you look around, you'll see a few people wearing their regalia and their medals, and that medal is often the Teaching Award. It's a really honorable achievement. She's also won awards from the UC System-wide Academic Senate and the Staff Assembly. She's served both as Chair of Comparative Literature and as Associate Dean of the Graduate Division at UCLA, and as Chair of UCLA's Academic Senate. She's published over 100 research articles on a variety of comparative topics, from Romanticism to the present, featuring American and German literature especially. Professor Komar served as President of the American Comparative Literature Association in 2005 through 2007, and she was elected to the Executive Board of the International Comparative Literature Association for 2010 through 2019. She was a senior fellow at the Freiburg Institute for Advanced Studies in 2012. Her current research interests and publications focus on the ways in which technology changes our literary paradigms and on issues of the relationship of the humanities to society, as well as early 20th century literature and crime fiction. I'm pleased to welcome Professor Kathleen Komar to deliver an address to you.
Graduates, parents, family, loved ones, and friends, today's really your day. Congratulations yet again. We all know how much support and sacrifice is involved in getting each of you to this very happy day, and we got to meet some of your families today, which was a privilege for us. The Greek playwright Aeschylus said that we must suffer into knowledge. And those of you who took my lower division 2C class can verify that we did our duty and made you suffer into knowledge. But today, all the suffering we may have put you through has paid off. And let me first affirm for the parents out there that it was definitely worth it. For those of you who worry that a humanities degree might not be the most practical degree to have, let me reassure you that your student has acquired a great many skills that will have practical applications in the real world. First, humanities students learn to deal with complex written or spoken or visual or oral material. They learn to see patterns and to ferret out the underlying issues. They learn to formulate questions about that material and to do the research necessary to answer those questions. They learn to develop evidence for their positions and to present that evidence in compelling written and spoken arguments. They learn to understand other cultures and other points of view and to value the work of their colleagues so that they can function collaboratively. They learn languages in addition to English so that they can perform in a larger global community. And they've learned to absorb new materials efficiently and to think critically about them. If you're a business person or a lawyer or a doctor or an Amazon executive or a social worker or a teacher, aren't these the very skills you would want in hiring a new employee? A highly intelligent, critically thinking person who can both listen and express themselves clearly to help solve the complex problems of any workplace, whatever they may be. So rest assured, the skills your student has acquired are what they will need to succeed, and what our country as a whole will need in order to survive. This occasion makes me think back to my own years in college, which were like 50 years ago, literally. After 8 years of Catholic grade school and 4 years of an all-girls Catholic high school, I decided to explore the larger world. I applied to the University of Chicago, but with one little difficulty. The nuns, who, by the way, really did provide me with a wonderful education, would not write me letters of recommendation, since they considered the University of Chicago a heathen institution that would surely lead me astray. So I first realized the ability to write compellingly was crucial when I had to write an essay explaining to the admissions committee why I was applying with no letters of recommendation. Much like UCLA, Chicago introduced me to a whole new world of fellow students very different than myself. And in the 4 years of college, I came to respect the diversity that my colleagues represented. We bonded in mourning the deaths of Martin Luther King Jr. and Bobby Kennedy. We occupied downtown Chicago during the 1968 presidential convention, and we came to understand what police violence really meant. We ended up demonstrating together for civil rights and against racism. We picketed for women's rights and for a more inclusive workforce. We fought against bigotry and prejudice and for the farm workers who picked crops in the fields of Illinois. We attacked the stubborn resistance to recognizing scientific principles in the realities they presented. We protested gun violence and struggled to get gun control laws. We challenged poverty and homelessness. And we consoled one another on the friends and loved ones we lost in the Vietnam War. As I was reminiscing about my college days, I realized that all those battles that we thought we won back in the 1960s are back. They're now yours to fight again. And they're even more urgent and crucial than they were 50 years ago. We might find this fact incredibly depressing, except that I know my students and all the graduates here in the hall today are more than equal to the task. I know that you are all lucky enough and talented enough and determined enough to go to one of the world's great universities. I know that you've learned to think critically, to respect all your friends and the differences they bring to your lives, and to appreciate how that diversity enriches us all. I know that you're equipped to think beyond all the wild claims about what is true in order to find what you know to be accurate. I know that you've learned to value the cultural products of other people and the different perspectives those bring. I'm sure that when you leave UCLA, you will take all that you have learned here out into many different fields and jobs. And I'm confident that your presence in all those many arenas will help to spread UCLA values. When you restage all those battles from my college days, you will do so with confidence and enthusiasm, knowing that you have all the tools you need to succeed, and knowing that all of us are counting on you to win for yourselves, for UCLA, for the country, and for the world at large. The past may be in my memory, but the future is in your hands. Thanks for letting us all get to know you and to share in your journey. You keep us inspired. You will leave here with a world-class education from one of the world's great universities, a public university, open to all of us. As a faculty member, I feel privileged to teach at this institution. And my husband, Ross Scheidler, and I have contributed fellowships so that undergraduate students can study abroad during their UCLA careers and get to experience other cultures firsthand. We hope that you will remember and help those who come after you at UCLA as well. A famous poem by the German-speaking poet, Rainer Maria Rilke, about an encounter between a museum goer and a sculpture of Apollo, records the transformative power of art and of human cultural production. The poem ends with the artwork and the poet making a crucial demand on the person contemplating. The last line is, "You must change your life." We hope that wrestling with all the cultural production you encountered in the humanities at UCLA has changed your lives. And rest assured that getting to share that experience with you has also changed ours. Thank you, good luck, and once again, congratulations.